What's up, guys? Welcome to Newswave Weekend Review, where we go through all of the previous week in Newswave, check out the biggest topics, and then check your comments on the different subjects. So if you've missed any of the Newswaves previously this past week, this would be a good way to kind of get you caught up on some of the bigger topics. Again, though, you can always go back and rewatch some of them or watch them if you missed them. But let's check out what you guys had to say. On Monday, we talked about Switch sales in Canada and how they have now passed the PS4 for the year of 2017 for total units sold. We also took a look at the new Ryzen mobile APUs that will start to appear in laptops and Ultrabooks going forward. The new Ryzen chips proved to be more than a match for Intel laptop chips and even are compared to some of the new i5 desktop processors. Philip Stafford says, "Yet once again, AMD is behind the times. If it can't compete with the i7, don't bother, AMD. Also, you shouldn't use the term mobile to describe laptops in a world of tablets and smartphones." Well, to be fair, I think you can use the term mobile for any of the processors that are in any of the laptops, really, because, well, that's what they themselves call them, mobile processors. And that's what we've been calling them forever, since before cell phones and tablets. I understand that it can be confusing, but that's just the way it is. That's what we call them, essentially. But the reason they, in this case, compared them to a desktop i5 and not a desktop i7. The desktop i7 does run away with it, but a desktop i5 is stronger than any of the i7 Ultrabook processors, and that's why they compared it to that, because, to be honest, at this point, those Ryzen mobile chips against an i7, like a 7500U, for example, processor, it's not a fair fight. The Ryzen runs away with it completely. So they had to seriously go up to a desktop processor to give it a fair fight. The i7 current line in Ultrabooks and everything just don't stand up to Ryzen. That's why I assume at this point Intel is already working on an answer to it, and they'll probably be out sometime next year with a big announcement as to how the i7 line will evolve with Ultrabooks. But we'll have to see. If anything, this is great for competition, because I'd expect Intel and AMD to really start fighting it out now that AMD has kind of found their place in the market with really more affordable processors that have more threads and can run better. On Tuesday, we talked about Nintendo's financial results from their investors meeting. Nintendo showed that as of the conclusion of September, there are now 7.63 million Switch units shipped to stores. This, of course, means that the Wii U lifetime sales are within reach in the Switch's first year. Nintendo also raised their forecast from 10 million units to 14 million units for the fiscal year. Sony also had a games presentation in Paris showing off several indie games and updated us on bigger games such as The Last of Us 2 and Spider-Man. Echo Cookie says, "I think outselling the Wii U in the first year will be a great goal. I definitely think they will be over 14 million by March." I think this as well. I think the Switch is easily going to cross that 14 million mark by March. And keep in mind that their prediction for 14 million is just for this fiscal year. That doesn't include the 2.74 million that were sold in March last fiscal year. So if they're at 14 million this fiscal year by March, by that end, they'll technically be at 16.74, somewhere in there. So you might be surprised. They might actually end up at like 17 million by then. Big, big improvement over the Wii U. But I do think this more than justifies how much of a failure the Wii U was from a marketing and sales perspective. And really, Nintendo at this point is competing with something that wasn't successful for any company, which helps them a lot in the Switch's run here, because it shows that they have completely night and day transitioned from what was very, very poorly received with the Wii U to something that is overwhelmingly positive reception with the Switch. And I don't think the second year is going to slow down. If anything, I think it'll increase more as they produce better first quality games going forward and more third party support that will jump on. The problem with the Wii U, and the reason no third party jumped on, is because it wasn't selling. It was confusing consumers and there wasn't really a place for it. They had the idea, but the technology wasn't there yet. NVIDIA has this Tegra chip that makes the entire concept possible. And here we are with a system that is much more clear cut as to what it's trying to do and what it's trying to be, and a consumer base that has now latched on that I think is being outnumbered. I think Nintendo fans are being outnumbered by mainstream now with the Switch, because we see how it's selling. And if you want to say the Wii U was only picked up by Nintendo fans, that means there's 13 million Nintendo fans that are willing to buy the Switch. So what happens when we get to next March, right, and there's almost 17 million? Are you then admitting that it's not just Nintendo fans buying it? It'll be interesting. On Wednesday, we went over changes that EA has made to the loot box system in Battlefront 2. These changes came in response to fans' backlash during the beta, claiming it was very pay-to-win, since those who put money in would have an advantage. On the same day, Sony released their financial information for the previous fiscal quarter, showing 67.5 million PS4s have now shipped, and they raised their projections to 79 million to be shipped by the end of fiscal year in March 2018. Arkham Ninja says, EA really gave the finger. First, you could get an Epic Star card from loot crates. Now you have to craft it by getting parts from loot crates. What does that even mean? Now people who want to buy them will be paying even more to get them, while people who don't want to pay will have to grind way more, will be even more unlikely to get the card. In EA's mind, the world is stupid, and it probably is. So here's the thing about EA with Battlefront 2. They probably didn't have to make any of these changes, to be honest. The backlash was there, but let's be realistic here. It has Star Wars printed on it. It's going to sell at a time when the new movie is coming out, and Star Wars fans are just hungry for anything Star Wars. I mean, it's coming out, what, like almost a month before, and like 3 weeks before the movie. At that point, if you're a fan of Star Wars, you're probably buying this just because you want that build up to the movie coming out. You're just looking for anything Star Wars, any kind of content. They could have made this game completely pay to win, and it would still have probably sold over 10 million copies. That's just the reality that we live in right now. And EA knows it. EA knows that the Star Wars name is worth that much to get people on board with it. If it wasn't a Star Wars game, if this was like something else, Battlefront or something like that, it wouldn't sell well, and they would have to bend over backwards to make this work. But because they have the namesake there, they have the namesake with FIFA, they have the namesake with Madden, these series are just running because of their names at this point, and they know that. So I'm actually a little surprised they even made any changes, but the changes they made still don't really make it less pay to win. It does make it less pay to win, but it's still kind of pay to win with what they're describing. I think at this point, unless it somehow bombs, which I don't think it will, they'll continue these microtransactions and loot crates at this point. On Thursday, we went over sales numbers in Japan, showing Mario Odyssey topping the charts as expected, along with Switch units selling well over 100,000. Despite big sales, EA made everyone aware that they are hesitant around the Switch and will be waiting until the first full year is turned in from Nintendo to decide how to approach the audience of the little system. Yami says, I think EA is hesitant to put games on the Switch because people are less likely to buy microtransactions and loot boxes because Nintendo games don't have them. The mentality for Nintendo consoles is quite different than the other two because of Nintendo's existence. This was a good point that Max brought up, a Dreamcast guy, over on Twitter when I had talked about this previously with EA. I think both people have a point here. I think Max had a point, and I think Yami also has a point. In different ways. I do think EA wants games as a service to be like their main focus. Like, that's it. They want people to have a reason to come back, whether it is constant updates for multiplayer aspects or constant updates for loot boxes, loot crates, and stuff to collect, and then you put more money in. That's the idea. Their monthly active user count is very important to them right now, and they're going to continue that. But I do think with Nintendo's overall setup with their online service, I don't think it's as accommodating to EA as they would like it to be. And what I mean by that is the voice chat is still kind of weird. And I don't think it's a streamlined for them to go on there, charge you a credit card through Nintendo service along with their game and money to come back. I think there's still stuff that Nintendo is working out with their online service because we don't even know what the paid online service is at this point. And EA wants that online service to be stable to the point where they can run your credit card constantly and really have you, the consumer, understand why you're doing it. And Nintendo's putting out a lot of games that don't have that microtransaction thing built in. Sure, they have amiibos, but you buy an amiibo and you have it. There's no, you don't go to the store and open up a box that is completely blank, like one of those gacha type eggs that you get, where you don't know what's in there. You know what you're buying when you buy an amiibo. It's, you know, $13 and you're out and that's it. In this case, though, I think EA is, they're trying to figure it out. I don't think it has anything to do with the audience because we've seen that the audience is very varied with the Switch right now. I mean, we see different sports figures, different teams buying them, and then we also see kids buying them and we see adults buying them. So I think after the chart that Nintendo released where it showed that more mature audiences are actually buying the Switch compared to younger audiences, I think EA is just trying to see what Nintendo has in store for their online services at this point. On Friday, we talked about Monster Hunter developers snubbing loot boxes, essentially saying they don't want people to pay extra money to skip their game. We also went over Cuphead's interesting physical release, if you can even call it that. What they're doing is they're releasing a box that has a code inside that you then punch in, so essentially you're just buying a box. Historic Duel says, Capcom doesn't deserve most of the credit for that. To that, I'll give to the Monster Hunter development team. After I picked this comment up, it was kind of answered underneath anyway, and it's a point I wanted to make because we do rag on Capcom a lot, right? Like, we say Capcom is so mismanaged, and they are. I'm not going to pretend like they're not. But in this case, Capcom could have easily forced the development team to implement some kind of loot box, loot crate, something. They easily could have done that because, you know what, they're the boss. They could have said, hey, we want this game to have recurring revenue and that's it, make it happen. And they would have been forced to make it happen. Capcom seems to be letting the Monster Hunter team do what they want. And I think that's because Capcom understands that right now there is a lot of pressure on companies to not put loot boxes in. The consumers are very frustrated with them, but they still keep putting loot boxes in because based on the namesake, they know you'll buy it. This is Monster Hunter's first real move to the PS4, to the Xbox One, to the PC, to where it's very mainstream, and they want to sell a lot of copies total. They don't want you to feel turned off. They don't want you to be like, nah, I'm not going to do it. And it is an online game, so in their mind, things down the road, things like DLC or stuff like that would probably net them money in the long run anyway. And they, if anything, they would look at loot boxes down the road, maybe in a sequel or something. I don't know, maybe they just don't like them. Maybe they like their game, they're so confident in their game that they want you to actually play it because they don't believe in the mentality of loot boxes either. Like, I don't really believe in it at the same time. I understand from a business perspective, as I was a person at the top of EA, I'm running EA, I'm the boss, and all the money's coming to me. Yeah, you're probably going to put loot boxes in because you have to make investors and shareholders happy to a degree. But in this case, Capcom, Monster Hunter developers team, I don't know if they're just honorable or they just don't see any real need to put it in because they like their game so much, but I'm glad everyone on that side, including Capcom, actually made a good move here and said, eh, no loot boxes, let's just sell the game. All right, and that'll do it for NewsWave Week in Review. Thank you so much for watching and commenting on all of the videos. I like to pick the different comments as we go through, so make sure you're commenting down below any of the videos with any responses or any ideas you have about the topics that we discuss throughout the week. It's a lot of fun. Thanks, guys, for tuning in every week. You guys have really helped the show grow over time. I mean, the amount of likes on some of those videos is staggering even to me at this point. And it just continues to grow, so thanks so much for that. Guys, I'll see you next Saturday. We'll do this every Saturday. I really like going through the comments, so it's going to be a regular thing. So thanks, guys, for tuning in. Monday, we have the next news wave, so I'll see you then.